My name's Joel Hallis, let me run set off. I'm going to talk to you about having a game. We're going to run a little long. I warned people about that. They put me in the last presenter, so hopefully we can roll over if anybody has to get off the church in their way. So I understand.
Don't back up here from the wire.
Yeah. It's going to be tricky.
If you need to just pay for it, you do that.
I want to
pay
for it. But if not, I can do the space bar for you.
Sorry.
Yeah, well, no, I'm doing that for you.
Oh, I
can do that. Yes, I got it under control. That's sort of went at me.
Excuse me, Joel's here in F1NA. Mr. Flip here?
Yes, I hear some disabled child.
Okay. First, let's talk about the game. We all generally have an idea of what the game means. Game means making a signal stronger, right? And if we have an amplifier that has 10 dB of gain, that means in power.
We can use about 3 dB gain on the audio.
Actually, maybe more like 6.
60 dB.
Well,
that means we need full quieting from the group.
Yeah.
No noise loud enough. I think it's a signal and noise problem. So let's keep the noise level down. Maybe we can make it work. Otherwise, I can stand out there. I guess
just talk loud.
I can't point. It's only so loud I can go. I have a system. Anyway, gain means an increase in signal strength. You put 10 watts into an amplifier with a power gain of 10. You would expect to get 100 watts out. That's pretty straightforward. Everybody's pretty clear on that, I guess. Hopefully.
I got it.
Okay. But what's really happening? We put in 10 watts and get 100 watts out, that's true. But we also have a power supply that's delivering 12 volts DC at 20 amps to the amplifier also. So we have to look at the whole picture to see what's happening. And what's really happening is, what's really happening is we have converted 240 watts of DC plus 10 watts of RF into 100 watts of RF. Everybody get the picture here?
Yep.
So we're putting in two kinds of signals here. We're putting in the RF signal and the DC power that's powering the amplifier. So if you thought about it, we'd probably expect we never get more out than we put in. Otherwise, we've invented perpetual motion. So just keep that in mind. Don't get out any more than you put in. You just get it somewhat differently than you put it in, perhaps. You hope.
I got it.
Let's talk about antenna gain. First of all, we talk about isotropic antennas. What do we mean by that? I have a little reference to the Greek down here if you're interested. But the basic idea is an isotropic radiator is one that radiates equally in all directions. Think of a light bulb supported by a couple of wires with nothing else around it, far, far away. It's a perfect example of that if it were an ideal light bulb, right? It radiates in all directions. And whatever, some fraction of the power we put into it turns into heat, the rest of it turns into light, and it's distributed all the way around, right? Now, what we often do with a flashlight bulb or a headlight bulb, a reflective surface behind it, right? So what happens is the amount of light that we put out or that we receive on the side in front of the reflector, I'll call it the high energy region, gets the benefit of the light that's radiated directly from the bulb plus the light that's reflected from the reflector. What about behind the reflector? Well, typically we get almost nothing back here. So again, we haven't really gotten more light, just focused it where we want it, in front of the reflector. That's sort of what we do with antennas. That's right. Keep that example in mind. The bottom line, we never get more out than we put in, as you would expect. And this is true for an amplifier as well as the antenna. Now, with the antenna, we get a little bit less because there will be losses in the antenna. There's no antenna that's perfect. We have connection losses, other kinds of losses. But whatever amount of energy we can focus someplace, we can put the energy where we want it, and that's what's important. If you're trying to work somebody in Australia, it doesn't matter that the folks in England can't hear you. It matters that the guy in Australia can hear you, right? So that's what we want to do. We want to put it where we want it. Now, there's a little minor complication when we go from a light bulb analogy to the antenna analogy. The light bulb radiation is incoherent. The exception of light, of course, is a laser, which operates much like a radio signal. But with an incoherent radiation, the phase is random. We just get the total energy that comes out of the bulb. We don't notice the difference in phase. Radio waves, as with lasers, are coherent. That is to say, the phase is defined and we can take advantage of it. It's very important to understand that when we talk about antenna gains and how we make antenna gains. Okay. Now, what is about a relative phase of signals that we receive from an antenna? If we get signals from multiple antennas that are in phase, they add. Get signals that are out of phase, they subtract. And if we get phase signals that are in between, in phase and out of phase, the result is in between, adding and subtracting, depending on how much. So here's a radio wave showing as you can see it on an oscilloscope. This is the amplitude going this way. This axis, depending on how you look at it, is either time or space. Either say, as I move away from the antenna to the signal source, the signal will vary in this way, or if I take a snapshot at a particular place, as time goes on, the signal will go up and down. Right? So the phase has to do with whether the signal is going positive or negative at a particular instant. Does that make sense?
Relative to something.
For example, if we have two signals, same frequency, and they're in phase, they're both going positive at the same time, they're both going negative at the same time, if we combine them or receive them someplace, the signal that we will end up with is the combination, in this case, the 1 and the 1 adds 2, and the minus 1 and minus 1 adds a minus 2. So we get a signal of twice the amplitude of either one of these if they started out the same. Everybody get that? A really important concept. Now, if the signals are out of phase, so this one's going positive at the same time this one's going negative, and this one's going negative at the same time this one's going positive, what we end up with is zero. So keep that in mind and think of the reflector situation a little bit. And so this might represent what you get behind the reflector, and the other one what you get in front of the reflector if you do it right. Okay? Going back to our light bulb.
Space bar.
Pardon me?
Space bar.
No, I got it. Okay, let's take a simple example. Best if we just have one eye closed. If we have a vertical half-wave dipole in free space, this is a pretty straightforward example. This represents the source in the middle or a transmission line that you radio someplace else. Current at an instant is going this way, of course the next instant is going the other way, but just to get an idea, we talk about the current going like that. And the radiation from this dipole is proportional to the sine of the angle with respect to the current direction. What that means is its maximum is probably not perpendicular to the axis of the antenna. And its minimum off the ends, right? So these are vectors tending show the sort of the magnitude that the signal is propagating. And you see the arrow here is very small, as it is here. So that's our vertical dipole. Now, notice, is this an isotropic antenna? No, it's not, because it's not radiating equally in all directions. In the axis, elevation axis in this picture, it's not radiating here. So therefore, the there must be more energy going here than there would be if it had been isotropic, right? Because the energy's got to go someplace.
I need a different antenna in my house.
Okay. Now we can model this antenna using EasyNet, one of my favorite tools. And this dark line represents the antenna's position. And this is looking at the elevation. And of course, with the antenna that's a vertical antenna, free space elevation pattern will be the same in every azimuth, right? No matter where you are. It's omnidirectional azimuth. And what EasyNet tells us is that the intensity going perpendicular to this antenna is stronger than it would be for an isotropic by 2.14 decibels, which is a 1.6 times the power. So going this way, we have 1.6 times the power we would have had for an isotropic. Going this way, we're down essentially all the way to what we get essentially zero times the power. So we've actually refocused our energy in perpendicular to the antenna. Everybody clear on that? See if I can get this right by the time I'm done. If we look down on this antenna, as I said, the plot is equal in all azimuths. This is the azimuth plot. Still have the same gain as you'd expect. Maximum elevation. I'm bound to get this before we've done plenty of slides, so I've got time. Same one?
There you go.
Now, suppose we, instead of having it in free space, outer space, suppose we have it above ground. What happens? We get any elevation angle from the antenna, we get the sum of the signal coming directly from the antenna and the signal reflected from the ground. Okay? So this isn't quite like the headlight situation, but it's a reflector in a different place. And it also is not, it's real ground, it's not a perfect reflector. You know, shine your headlights at it and tell the difference between that and the mirror, right? Same thing with radio signals. Now, with a vertical antenna, it can be shown that the reflection from the ground is same phase as the signal at distance. So the two signals that arrive at a receiving antenna someplace are the sum of these two signals, and the phase difference depends on the difference in this length. This length is 180 degrees of phase, for example, which it will be at some angle. Then the signals will be out of phase and they'll cancel. They're 0 degrees phase difference, which is almost never happening exactly. Or 360 degrees, the signals will add because then they'll be in phase. Right? Are you clear on that? So that's what happens. Now we can look at that situation with EasyNet, which that means is one of the things that happens with a vertical antenna, we'll see this on the plots, is that over real ground you get kind of low energy right at the horizon, whereas over perfect ground you can get a lot of energy at the horizon. That's why vertical antennas work so great if you're next to the water, seawater, and they don't work quite as well for long distances if you're in Connecticut with the rocks and sand. That's a good point. And it does. Now, we'll.
There you go.
Okay, fine. So, let's take the example of perfect ground. That antenna over perfect ground, there actually is a reinforcement at 0 degrees at a far distant point. And it adds significantly notice we have a number of places where we get, this is 180 degrees total length, so we get a null. This is 360, 540, is that right? So, anyway, the different angles as you have the resulting in a different path length in the two pads. And notice what happens. Because we have so much energy that's not going in these regions, we end up with a lot more in this region, so it has to go someplace. And in fact, EZNIC says the peak gain is 8.21 decibels compared to an isotropic, which is interesting. Now, what does that mean? 8.21 decibels compared to an isotropic? Well, if you're saying, well, what about comparison to a vertical dipole in free space? Well, that had a gain of 2.14 dB, right? So the gain of the antenna over perfect ground compared to an antenna in free space is a little more than six decibels. So it's got 6 dB gain over a dipole in free space, which is 4 times the power. So we take that antenna that's in free space, we bring it down to our Long Island Sound, our steel hull boat in Long Island Sound, and we have 4 times the power going out. That's significant. But notice that we have 2 different ways we can describe this antenna's gain, right? We can describe it as, well, this antenna has 8.2 decibels compared to an isotropic. But that's kind of an interesting number, but since you can't build an isotropic antenna in real space, in the real world, kind of helpful. Or we can say it has 6 dB gain over the dipole. Look for 2 numbers we use to describe the. Now, suppose we go over real ground. Again, as I mentioned, what happens is because the reflected signal is attenuated, as we pointed out, the nulls are not as deep. You don't get complete cancellation, right? But you do get significant cancellation off the end because there's nothing going up off the end of the antenna to start with, so there's not going to be any more just because there's crummy ground. And this antenna will have a peak gain of 2.93 decibels. Why? Because this first peak is a result of the incident signal plus a reflection of a reduced level of reflection from the real ground. And if we had a signal going right along the ground, it would be even stronger, but because that's attenuated by the losses of the dirt, we don't have that much there. So that's, what do we have here? This has a gain of almost 3 decibels over an isotropic, but it's only 0.79 decibels compared to the dipole in free space. So this is all talking about the same antenna, notice. Now, if I'm advertising this in a sell one, I've got a number of numbers that I could use to describe the gain. Which one would I probably pick?
The bigger one.
So that's something you have to watch. You know, people talk about gain over compared to an isotropic, and that's actually a good measure, even though you won't achieve it necessarily at home. But at least it's all to the same basis. If you're comparing two antennas and they both talk about gain compared to an isotropic, that's a reasonable measure for comparison. On the other hand, if you talk about gain compared to a dipole, what I think is important to know is what kind of dipole it is. Is it a dipole in free space? In which case you have, this antenna would have a gain of less than a dB. Or is it a dipole over a perfect ground? Or over perfect ground, this antenna has a loss, has less gain, right? So, a lot of numbers you can pick.
I got it.
Okay. Now, suppose you make this go higher, go 10 wavelengths above real ground. In this case, we don't get a signal at the horizon, but we get one much closer because we're higher, right? So with the loss, it's right along the ground, it's in a smaller area, we actually get a stronger signal here. We get 4.56 decibels, or 0.86 times the power. So this same antenna now raised up higher has a gain of 6.7 dBi or 4.6 dB above the dipole of free space. We got another measure we can use in this antenna for IA if we wanted. It's making sense.
I got it.
Now, suppose we take that antenna and we make it horizontal instead of vertical. If we look down at this antenna, and this is in free space, so we're looking right at the horizon. There's no reason not to, there's no reflections from the ground, because there is no ground. Right? What we see is a pattern very similar to what we saw with the vertical antenna if we were looking at it from the side, but now we're looking at it looking down on it. The reason for that is in free space, there is no up or down, right? Everything is just the same, right? So the gain, for some reason, is slightly at 2.15 decibels instead of 2.14. We'll leave that as an editorial problem. But essentially, this is a gain of 2.15 dB compared to a isotropic, or because it's a dipole, it's 2.0 dB compared to a dipole, as you'd expect. Of course, we can't I guess we could do free space, but maybe you get to an VHF in the balloon, for example, if you don't have anything conductive.
I got it.
Now, let's take the horizontal dipole above the ground. This is a slightly different case. The boundary conditions are such that when the wave hits the ground and reflects from a horizontal antenna, the phase is actually shifted. That's why a horizontal antenna, even over a perfect ground, does not have this signal that adds at the horizon and cancels at the horizon to quite a different elevation pattern. But we have the same basic idea, which is the difference in the path length. We've shown it here as if you had a image antenna below ground. Actually construct the difference in path length geometrically by having an imaginary antenna below ground. Choose to do that. And at the at some angle, there will be a path difference of a half wavelength. And if there is, now these signals will add constructively to combine. Because it's out of phase here, and having a 180 degree phase shift in path length. If anybody goes back far enough to remember the Larson Graff April article describing the antenna, the image antenna, I actually pulled that from a quote that somehow didn't
be back on
the above ground. So
yeah, I think his point was the deeper you put the antenna, the higher will be the image antenna in space.
Well, that's right. That's exactly the way it works. So you put this antenna higher, the image is.
They work better with the deeper.
Yeah, I think it only works if you're talking to somebody inside the Earth.
Yeah. Moment.
But I actually underground antennas do work to some extent. Minuteman Missile System has an arrangement of PLF buried antennas that can be used to launch the missiles and other things don't work. Because the rather clever system designs was using leased telephone lines as their primary communication. And of course, they run over the old poles in North Dakota, 15 miles back from the central office. And the first anything going on, the poles were gone. So they had to have backup systems. So the MF radio was one of those. I spent some time trying to figure out what would happen to the MF radio if you had a buried antenna, if you had a 6-foot amplitude shockwave coming from the Earth. Particularly if a mole had nicked the insulation. Anyway, amazing things the government will spend. But anyway, so it is possible to have Faraday antennas, but mostly we use above ground antennas because they work much better if you're communicating something above ground.
Got it.
So here's that horizontal dipole a halfway over perfect ground. And as you notice, even though it's perfect ground, we have no signal at the horizon. That's a big difference between vertical and horizontal antennas. If you're over perfect ground or seawater, vertical antenna will have great low angle radiation, even if it's right on the ground, at the ground. Horizontal antenna, halfway above the ground, over perfect ground, will have a maximum signal at 30 degrees. But notice it's fairly strong up there, 8 dB, so it actually has at 10 degrees, it has a signal of maybe 3 dBi. So that's why I say the usual threshold for me is about half a wave. If you want to work EX, and you can get a half wave or higher with a horizontal antenna, you'll probably end up with a bigger signal in its directions than you will with a vertical antenna if you live on dirt. That's good. But anyway, so this, again, it's our same half-wave dipole we were talking about, but now we're holding it this way, and we have a gain of 6 dB over a three-phase dipole. And
okay, you got it.
I suppose you put it over real ground. Well, notice it's not too terrible. This is at 20 meters, half-wave over real ground, it's about 34 feet. And instead of the 8 dB we have, we get 7.3 dBi gain at 30 degrees, 29 degrees actually, cancellation. In fact, somebody mentioned something to me a long time ago that I think still is true today as it was then, and that is that crummy ground, a horizontal antenna has an advantage because the reflected signal that cancels at low angles reflected less. Whereas if you have a vertical antenna, crummy ground, you get more cancellation at the horizon. Even though they both look about the same. But the signal here is actually stronger, so you have more signal left at low angles.
So, Joel, are we always assuming at least a half wave physical length above ground for this antenna?
No, I mean it will work at any height.
It will work at any height.
But what happens is as you go lower and lower, this angle where the air goes higher and higher, and as you get down below a half a wavelength, you start to put much of your signal and if you want to work 80 meter NBIS, or local regional communication, it's exactly what you want. In fact, at about a quarter wavelength, it's about the optimal height for NBIS work. And people have made them work at low trip heights and stuff. They don't work efficiently there, but they will work. Quarter wave is perfect for that. And even at a quarter wave, you get some radiation left at the low angles, but it's not as much. So it's not, you can't work TX with low antenna. It's just harder. You're better off with an FT8 or a CW or something. And 500 watts into a low horizontal antenna is about as good as 5 watts into a very high horizontal antenna for the TX. But with FT8, work the world 5 watts.
So, and this is halfway vertical. And so, depending on the band I'm using, if I raise it up or lower it down, I'm changing my takeoff angle. The higher up it is, or the lower down it is, yes. I might actually get it so high up that it doesn't work.
Well, yeah, that's true. But remember, we had that picture of 10 wavelengths, just not all that high, 2 meters, that's 20-60 feet. So you put it on top of a four-story building, and that's probably where you are. You actually, on that 10 wavelength, you get a lot more gain at very low angles. But the problem is, you go up a little bit, and you're into a null. So the nulls and the peaks come back and forth much more quickly. Now, why is that a problem? Well, I have an antenna like that on the top of my sailboat mast, and my peeling. That might mean I can talk to some people, but not if I'm straight up, I'll have a slow angle. The angle is more clear. want to talk to somebody on the top of the hill like a repeater, it's quite possible to have a high antenna, but have a null in that direction. And if you fix that one, then it doesn't work in this repeater on the top of another one. So you have to be a little careful, but you're absolutely right. If you have it, the higher you go, the lower the first load will be. As we noticed here, we went from, so right now at halfway, this peak is at 29 degrees. If we go up to the full wavelength, what we'll see is we'll end up with a more complex pattern with a null in the middle, and we'll end up with the first peak lower. Well, that happens on 2 meters as well, but as you go up higher and higher with the antenna, you get more and more nulls and peaks. And even on HF it can be a problem, because you're working on ionospheric propagation. There are certain angles that will get you to where you want to go. The lower angles tend to get you further. If you're trying to work somebody on a Greek island, you don't want a signal that's heading a lot towards Australia right over that. You want a sort of an intermediate angle, and some of those angles won't get through. So there's a number of articles about optimum height for antennas, and it just depends on the range. Halfway is not optimum by any stretch. The next.
Got it.
Okay, yeah, here's the that same dipole, one wavelength above the ground. Now notice that the first peak went down to 14 degrees. That's half the elevation angle of the peak, of the halfway by antenna, right? But listen to the
good.
At 30 degrees where we had our peak before, we now have a null. Because it's real ground, it's not a clean null. We're down about 15 dB, which is 3S units from what we have here. So, depending on where that station is that you're trying to get to on the ionosphere, if this is the angle to get there, you've got a 2 dB loss compared to what you would have if your antenna were lower. Some people address this by having antennas that go up and down. Other people do this by having multiple antennas on their tower, which is quite effective. I mean, if you have that 140 power like K3LR has, you can have 3 or 4 30-meter Yagis on it, and you can put them all in phase, head off at an intermediate angle, or just want the very lowest angle, you can use the top antenna by itself. So there's all kinds of combinations. For most of us, we have to try to pick an intermediate, reasonable height that will give us the angle. The other thing to keep in mind is if you have a multi-band antenna, the pattern for the halfway high antenna would be what it would be on 20, but that same 34-foot height on 10 meters would have a pattern like this, because now you're up to a full wavelength. So keep in mind, you've got multiple patterns going on if you have a multi-band antenna. So gain is good, but it's even better if you have it going where you want. That's the whole point.
Got it.
Let's take another example. Now we're going to talk about actual gain. You notice all the gain we've been talking about so far and all the different gain numbers have been involved in antennas that we don't think of as gain antennas, right? We're talking about a dipole. Dipole have gain. It has somewhere between 0 and 50 gain, which is right, depending on how you look at it. But we can get even more numbers. Let's take our vertical dipole in free space and talk about two antennas separated a half wavelength and fed in the same phase. Of course, the current is reversing, but they're both reversing at the same time. So that's a fairly common VHF antenna for some people. In fact, if you think of them as quarter wave whips fed against truck mirrors, there are many truckers do this on citizen band, right? You see an antenna on each mirror. And what happens? We're pretty good with that. Which is the next slide. So if you look down at it, what happens is, looking down, these are the two antennas. Because they're in the same phase, any direction that has the same path length from each antenna, they will add in phase, right? They'll add on this axis. So is on the angle perpendicular to the bisector. And because they're halfway apart, by the time this signal gets over here, the signal in this antenna has shifted from 180 degrees, it's that much time later. It takes half a cycle time to get there, and they're half a cycle apart. So by the time this signal gets here, they're out of phase and they cancel. By the time this signal gets here, they're out of phase and they cancel. That makes sense. This is kind of important. It's constant. Anyway, what happens is we get 3.6 decibels of gain, 2.3 times the power compared to a single antenna. Now this is great. I guess I mentioned some guy I worked with at one point was into truckers and campers and things, and trucking and all that sort of stuff. He was going for this and said, I'm going to get a lot of gain from having two antennas. Well, that's great. You're driving on a very straight road, and the people you want to talk to are on the same road. But as you can see, if the road doesn't have to curve very far, you did not be able to talk to somebody over here. So unless you're getting more than twice the signal in this direction, but you're getting 20, 60 feet, less than a hundredth of the signal for the people on that, in that direction. To fix that, but you had to switch and change the phase, which is something you can do. I don't know if you do that. Anyway, so that's a gain antenna. Now we're getting in, going for a non-gain antenna to an actual gain antenna. This is a phased array gain antenna with 2 hours. If we look at the elevation plot, again in free space, we have the same gain that we had 5.6 dB. And we just looking at the path for the maximum signal. And again, we have no signal at the end as we expect. Now, I guess what we'll do next is talk about it. Okay, we're trying the other again. As we said, if you're in that truck and you want to talk to somebody going the other way, if you switch the phase of one of the antennas, now, by the time this signal gets over here, this signal is in the opposite phase, and they add going this way and that way instead of this way and that way. So we have a change the direction. Does that make sense? Yeah, or what?
Change the lobes, yeah.
Pardon me?
Steer the lobes on the.
I steer the lobes on the. Exactly right. Steer the lobes on the. You see that. If we look at the azimuth plot now, notice before the signals were going this way, now they're going that way. This works well at HF too, by the way. If you have ground planes on your house and a party, you switch them just by switching in a plane with coax. Pretty much. And this has less gain. You'll notice the pattern is less sharp, has less gain, but it still has gain compared to a single dipole. Now, that's so far we've been talking about. Antennas at the same elevation. Another thing we can do is put one antenna on top of each other. And if we feed them in phase, what's going to happen where they're going to add? The signals will both be the same phase when they reach over here in the center, right? They have the same path length and they're both in the same phase to start with. So by doing this, what we do is we bring the radiation closer to the horizon. And this answers a question that comes in fairly frequently. How can you have a directional gain antenna that's omnidirectional? Given that we've said that gain means you're focusing the antenna. What you're doing, you're focusing the energy. What you're doing with a collinear, vertical collinear antenna is very tight. I don't know if that's one. How long is that?
This is for UHF, VHF, not 6 meters.
Okay, so that's multiple
dipoles.
That's on the list. I don't know how many are there,
depends on which band.
But anyway, so we have vertical dipoles in free space. What we get is doing a couple of things.
Okay.
We get, remember the pattern before was somewhat the azimuth, the elevation pattern of a single dipole in free space was wider. What we've done is we focused it more closely to the center. We've got additional gain now. We've got 3.6 dB. The
original antenna had 2.14, so we've got 1.5 decibels gain compared to a single current light bulb. 1.4 times the power. So that's an interesting
got it.
Now let's get to what HF people are, which is what happens if we have horizontal dipoles, one wave over real ground, and we separate them quarter wavelengths, and we feed them 90 degrees out of phase. This one is 90 degrees behind this one. Quarter wave of time later, this signal reaches here. By that time, this signal is now zero phase, so these signals will air that way. We got that. But this one, by the time this gets over here, this zero phase is down to minus 90, and the signals subtract. Where do we get? That's what we've done. We've completely eliminated the signal from the rear. We've actually made a beam antenna, a unidirectional beam antenna that is has two driven elements, one that are quarter way apart and is a 90-degree phase. And that actually can work. You can actually make that work. It's a little trickier than it sounds because what happens is the impedances of the antennas don't end up being the same because of the coupling and so forth. So if you could get the phase to be 90 degrees different and the same amount of power in each one, it would work just like that. And you, it's actually possible, but it's not trivial. So it's not just getting a quarter wave section of transmission. Hopefully you can get fairly close. So, and this antenna has a gain of, this is above real ground, 10.7 dBi, which is 8.6 dB greater than the dipole in space. You can say that's got 8.6 decibels gain over a dipole. But is it a fair comparison to compare a Yagi or a beam over real ground to a dipole in free space? I don't think so, because that same dipole in the same place as this antenna with one of the elements fell off, let's say, you would have, I guess you had 7.6 dB gain. And that means is this antenna actually has only 3 dB of gain compared to a single dipole in the same place. But you probably won't see that number. We have three different numbers if you describe this beam antenna. 10.7 dB, which is the gain compared to an isotropic antenna. 8.6 dB compared to a dipole in free space, but 3.1 dB compared to a dipole in the same place that the beam is. So that gives you an idea of the range of values you can have and why it's important to understand what they mean when you look at antenna amps.
The league doesn't enforce a standard for advertising, does it?
The league actually enforces it in a way. I think, I don't know, they still do this. Do you remember? For many years, they just said, the way we will enforce the standard is you're not allowed to publish game figures. Everybody has to find a way of doing it, and it doesn't make any sense. It's like they used to do with audio amplifiers. Remember all the different ways they were getting power?
Oh, right. RMS.
RMS.
Anyway, so say sure. So we just said no rating. And it was further exacerbated by the fact that the ARL labs, for many good reasons, did not have an antenna rating to be able to measure them, or they would have brought it to you, and that would be really great. We spent a lot of time at one point trying to work out a deal with somebody. There are not that many antenna ranges that can do HF antennas. There are some. Great if we could get somebody, especially if they were not somebody that manufactured hand antennas, or they would actually take data.
So what are we supposed to think when we're reading and
so often we do. This antenna has 3 dB gain. It doesn't say I or D or anything. It just says dB.
Well, I mean, this has 3 dB gain. I would sell it to you for less than whatever antenna you got.
So there's no agreed upon default of what dB means.
Well, no, dB means a power ratio.
Right, but it needs a comparison.
Well, it doesn't make it means a power ratio, and it only makes sense if it's a comparison. I always use DBI because it's always the same.
Yeah.
Even though it's not a number you can actually achieve, you can't make an isotropic antenna on our Earth. And as soon as you have it near Earth, you have reflections and it no longer is isotropic. So isotropic antennas could exist far space, but it can't exist here. But still, it's a reasonable number, because even talking about compared to a dipole, there are a number of different dipoles you can compare with. As we're talking about here, you can compare it with a dipole in free space or a dipole in the same place. So this would be to me, this is a very reasonable comparison. Have the gain as if the dipole you're comparing it to is in exactly the same place that the beam is. Now, of course, if you have a beam with multiple heights of filaments, you can compare it to the one on the top, or the one in the middle, or which one you compare it to, so you can get into trouble. So I like PDI, and also it's the default that comes up in these things, but we can have it. But 3dB makes a lot of sense, because what you've done essentially is you've taken the signal going to half the universe on this side and combined it with the signal going on this half of the universe, and what should be expected to be about twice as strong, just as you would with a reflector behind a light bulb. Clear on that? Then if you look down at it, this is what we get. Oh, here's another thing that's interesting. Talking about advertising. What is front to back? Front-to-back ratio, this even tells you what it is. The front-to-back ratio is usually defined as the ratio between the signal and the focus of the pattern going forward, the signal 180 degrees out. That's an interesting number, and that's often published, but it might be equally important to know the difference between the front and any signal in the rear. Because if you're trying to talk to somebody North Sea somewhere, right behind you, there might not be anybody, but it may be that this guy in South Jersey is of more importance to you than the guy in Ohio over here who doesn't have too big a signal kind of thing. So there's another measurement system we're talking about, and that is front to rear. Some people have just thought about that in their heads, so be aware of the difference. So this is the front to back ratio is 28.9 dB with this antenna. That requires very accurate measurements to get that measurement. The front to rear, I would estimate, is about 16 dB. That's more than a 10 dB difference on rearward signals. So while front to back is a good indication of how well the antenna is tuned, it doesn't necessarily tell you everything you want to know about how the antenna projects signals to back.
You got it.
Okay. Now, we're talking about antenna gain. Let's go back to our light bulb and our isotropic antenna. A bulb radiates directly in all directions, or equally in all directions, as we discussed. What that means is any place on the surface of this imaginary sphere surrounding the light bulb has exactly the same intensity. It's all the same. The power received in any part of the surface is just equal to the fraction of the surface, right? If you know the area that you're looking at, this is a receive antenna, you have an equivalent area this antenna has,
how much power you receive. You just receive the fraction of this area compared to the total area of the sphere. Does that make sense? You have the same amount of energy going everywhere, so the amount of energy you gather is just a question of how big the area is. Now, how do we do that? Well, first thing we need to know is what the area is of the sphere. This goes back to high school geometry or something. The area of a sphere is just 4 pi r squared, where r is the distance from the light bulb to the place where your antenna is. That tells you how much total area of the sphere has. And then you want to know how much power we actually get. These are two slides here.
No, I'll back it up.
So let's take an example. The power received is just the power transmitted from the center times the area of this surface that we put on the surface of the sphere, imaginary sphere, divided by the total area of the sphere. So let's run some numbers. Suppose we have a 10-watt transmitter, and this is 10 kilometers, and our receive antenna receives 1 square meter, receives over an area of 1 square meter. What do we get? If we just run the numbers, we get 10 times 1 over 4 pi times 10,000 meters squared. End up with about 8 nanowatts
power density.
That's the power we get. That's actually the power, the total power, the power density in that area. And if we use Ohm's law, I'm sorry, 0.008 microwatts, that's the total power. Doesn't sound like very much, but let's. You might want to know is if we have a 50 ohm receiver connection, our antenna receiver, the Ohm's law, we find we actually get 600 microvolts into our receiver. That's a pretty strong signal. That illustrates a couple of things. One, as the previous speaker was mentioning, as I was standing back and forth in the doorway trying to stop talking, with 1 watt or less, you can go many miles if you have line of sight path. That's the one caveat about this. This assumes a line of sight path, right? This does not take into account reflections or obstructions or anything else. But for line of sight work, it doesn't take much power. 10 watts, 10 kilometers, about 6 miles. What does it take to acquire a receiver? Is there 2 microvolts, 3 microvolts? So this is 100 times as much voltage of the receiver as you need to make a good signal. There are a couple of things. But the other thing to keep in mind is this way you can actually determine, if you're talking line of sight, how strong a signal you will put in to somebody with a receiver if you know the effective area of the receive antenna. It's kind of good. Now, suppose you have an obstruction. You say, well, for some reason I believe that that building puts in 10 dB or 20 dB of loss. What does that mean? Well, I just reduce this by 10 or 20 dB, and I don't see what I get. So I'm still giving you an idea, at least an estimate, if you have an idea about it. Similarly, if you talk about ionospheric propagation, it's a little bit of a stretch, but if you say, well, the path loss from two hops should be, it's 80 dB or whatever it is, I should be able to get an idea of how strong a signal I'm going to get to the far end. If I knew my transmit power, which I probably know, but the other thing I need to know is the effective area of the receive antenna. And what is the effective area of the receive antenna? Well, for a parabolic dish, it's pretty straightforward. It's some large fraction of the surface that the parabola intercepts. So it's just pi r squared, right? And usually it's having, you always always lose a little bit.
So you have to subtract the area of the feed port assembly and stuff like that. And then it's not perfectly A, so therefore it's that's a little less than, so maybe it's 90% of the area. And the higher the frequency you have, the more important surface irregularities can get. So I said I'd bring it all later, maybe it has to leave. What about a halfway dipole? You might think, well, it's just a little piece of wire, so how much area you could have. But what it really has shown that the capture area is made up to the game and so forth, and it works out. And if you imagine the surface for a halfway dipole, it's a half wave wide, a quarter wave high. That's effectively seeing the area dipole. The interesting thing about this is you'll notice that the effective area of a dipole is different. You would not be surprised to find depending on the band. So an 80 meter dipole, it's effectively 854 square meters. That's a pretty big chunk. On 2 meters, it's half a square meter. And on 70 centimeters, it's 0.06 square meters. Now, what does that mean? Well, that means that, I don't have a chart about this. No, I don't. Okay. I'm trying to make this short so I can finish what I do on the wall. If you go back. What this means is you'll see in like the ARL antenna book when I talk about propagation of VHF signals, and they show a plot for signal strength versus distance in different bands. If I were to make a difference, what band I'm on, if I don't want to send out a signal or receive a signal, why should it be? The difference is, we talk about how much we get, it's a question of what the area is that I'm receiving it in. So if all the areas were the same, the lines would be the same. Get the same amount. But what they don't usually tell you is the reason for the different path losses is that the effective area is smaller on the higher frequency. And what the net is, if you're radiating the same amount of power and you have an antenna that's about the same size, it will give you about the same signal on any band. So that means that if you have a dipole on 2 meters, you need to have 6 or 8 element array on 70 centimeters to get the same signal. So it's right in a way, but it's really, that's because that might give you the same effective area. If you're talking, if your antenna is a parabolic reflector, operate on different bands, the signal will be the same on each band because the area is the same. So when you look at those plots, keep that in mind. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I spent many years wondering why that would be. That's why it's correct, but it's a question of how you define it. So if you know, okay, how do I figure out what the effective area is of my super yank? If you know what the gain is, it's just that you receive that much more signal than you would it for the dipole. So just supply the gain back. So with this, you can figure out not only how much signal is there, but how much signal the receiver will receive. Trying to set up a repeater network, you can actually figure out if you have line of sight paths or higher. You can figure out how strong, how much power people will need to get into your repeater, how strong the feed works. And I kind of compressed this part a little. But anyway, I thought I had it here. After I did this presentation for a local club, I made it into a three-part particle series of 2S2. I don't remember when. I thought I had it. But if you look up antenna gain, W1ZR, over the last couple of years, there are three parts, and it talks about how much signal is out, how much signal is. I don't know. The third part is about this received thing, which is probably the more discussion.
times I've seen it.